Hey, John.
Hey, Eric. How you doing?
Pretty good. Thanks for stopping by.
Oh, no problem. What do you got?
Okay. What I'm looking at here is we have this old switchgear with an arc flash level of 68 calories. Management wants me to come up with a few solutions. There was an arc flash event at our Kansas facility, and it was very expensive.
We've talked before about the numerous arc flash solutions that Eaton has, but you might want to take a look at the arc quenching gear if you're going to replace the whole lineup at this point.
Sounds interesting. Give me the info, and I'll take a look at it and pass it along. I'm not sure what they'll say, but I'll get back to you.
There you go. I did bring you some information. You might want to stop by the Power Systems Experience Center in Pittsburghville when you get a chance to see it in action.
Okay, sounds good. Thanks, John. I really appreciate it.
Sure.
Hi, my name's Adams Baker. I'm the product manager for Eaton's low voltage switchgear. Here at Eaton's Power Systems Experience Center, we have a demonstration of our arc quenching switchgear. It's a new electrical safety solution that has already revolutionized arc flash safety. So in general, how does it work? In a typical lineup of arc quenching Magnum DS low voltage switchgear, we utilize wired point sensors installed throughout the equipment that will detect the flash of light from an arc flash. And we also use CTs on the incoming line that will detect a rise in current during a fault. You can see a point sensor up at the top of the incoming cable compartment, for example. There's also one at the bottom. There are three more point sensors located in the bus compartment and, importantly, point sensors located over the finger clusters of all of the draw devices. The locations of these point sensors are tested and validated at a high-powered test lab during actual arc flash events, so we know that regardless of where an arc flash initiates inside the switchgear, we'll be able to detect it. For this demo, the yellow chasing rope lights show the normal flow of current in the switchgear. The current comes in through the incoming line, flows into the line side of the main low-voltage power circuit breaker, out the load side, down the vertical bus, and then out into the horizontal bus, which would be distributed out to additional sections of feeder breakers. And you'll notice that it appears someone left a wrench magically levitating over that uninsulated bus bar. Let's lower that wrench onto the bus bar to create an arc flash and see what this system does when there's an arc flash inside the switchgear. I'll lower this wrench down onto the bus. Oh, big arc flash. Now you'll notice the blue chasing rope lights have illuminated. All of the current is now flowing into the blue arc quenching device. It's no longer flowing through the wrench, which initiated that arcing fault. So the arcing fault instantly extinguishes because all of the current flows into the arc quenching device. That actually occurs in a total of 4 milliseconds. That's at less than a quarter of a cycle. It takes about 2 milliseconds to detect the arc flash, which is done by the Eaton arc flash relay and those arc flash sensors that I pointed out, and another approximately 2 milliseconds to commutate that arc energy and contain it inside the arc quenching device until the main breaker opens up and de-energizes the lineup about 3 to 4 cycles later. So if you had an arc flash event, all you need to do is go up to the equipment, which is now de-energized. The relays will indicate which point sensors saw the arc flash, so you know where to go in the equipment to find the cause of the fault. You'll remove the cause of the fault and inspect the equipment, and then return it to normal operating condition, which should be relatively easy since the equipment will be protected from damage due to the quick reaction of the arc quenching system. And then you'll rack out the arc quenching device. It's a one-time use device, sort of like an airbag, and you'll replace it with a new one. If you don't have a new one on the shelf, that's okay. Once you clear the fault, you can still re-energize the lineup, but you won't get that 4 millisecond arc quenching time. And once you get a replacement arc quenching device, you can actually rack it onto the energized bus and be back up and fully protected. So with your skilled workforce, or with Eaton's engineering services on site, you can potentially have a lineup of switchgear recovered from an arc flash event in a matter of hours, instead of weeks or months, which may be required to repair or replace a heavily damaged lineup. In summary, Eaton's arc quenching switchgear is an incident energy reducing system. It can actually reduce the incident energy to less than 1.2 calories per centimeter squared. So this enhances safety, it enables the switchgear to exceed the arc resistant test requirements in standard construction without the need for ducts, plenums, thicker gauge steel, and the special construction that you normally expect with arc resistant equipment. And it even provides arc resistant protection when the doors are open or panels are removed. It also protects the equipment itself from damage, unlike arc resistant equipment, where the internals can be destroyed. and since it protects the equipment from damage, it can dramatically reduce downtime in the event of an arc flash. By now you must be wondering how the arc quenching device actually works to extinguish an arc flash inside the switchgear. Shown here are the internals of the arc quenching device. As you can see, there are two arc containment vessels inside. What's shown here are actually cutaways. Each vessel is about 7 inches tall, about 5 inches in diameter. They look a little like vacuum contactor bottles, but they're not. They're actually filled with atmospheric air because under certain circumstances, we actually want arcing to occur inside these vessels. You'll notice at the top of the left vessel, we connect phase A. At the top of the right vessel, we connect phase C. And to the bottom of both vessels, we connect phase B. And each of the phases is connected to contacts, shown in tan on this diagram. If this were a bolted fault device, one way to make it work would be to clap the contacts together whenever an arcing fault is detected. This would tie all three phases together in a zero impedance fault, which would divert all of the current from the arcing fault into this device, immediately extinguishing the arcing fault. But of course, we didn't want to create just another bolted fault device, because such devices run the risk of damaging the upstream power distribution equipment via the massive electromechanical forces that are created when they operate at full fault current. So instead, these tan contacts are actually fixed in place. The air gap between them doesn't change under any circumstances. Under normal operation of the switchgear, these contacts are far enough apart that there's no arcing across them. You can even high pot or dielectric test the equipment with the arc quenching device installed, and it will not cause the switchgear to fail the test. But under certain circumstances, we want to be able to create a lower impedance current path inside the arc quenching device in order to extinguish an unintended arcing fault. And the way we do that is by creating a fully contained lower impedance arcing fault inside each arc containment vessel. The arcing fault is created by using a trigger ribbon. It's essentially a wire. The ribbons shown here in blue run up the side of each of the lower contacts, across the top of each contact, down the side, and then they double back on themselves and return to the trigger board. So when we want to create a lower impedance current path to divert the arc energy into the arc quenching device, all we do is pass current through each of the trigger ribbons. As you may recall from physics class, when current flows through a wire, it generates a magnetic field, also called the Lorentz force, or a B field. And you can use what's known as the right-hand rule to determine the direction or flux of that magnetic field. So the current flows up the side of the contact, across the top of the contact. We'll call that a counterclockwise magnetic field. It goes across the top, down the other side, and then it doubles back on itself. And we have a clockwise magnetic field. In a matter of microseconds, we have created two opposing electromagnets in the wire. That causes the top half of the wire to be repelled from the bottom half, and it jumps up and hits the top contact. The trigger ribbons momentarily tie phase A to B and phase C to B. But the trigger ribbons are too thin to be able to conduct the available fault current and voltage. So the ribbons melt, they vaporize, and then they ionize. And when you ionize copper, you create an arcing fault. So we have spontaneously created two arcing faults that tie all three phases together. And that's how we create a current limited, lower impedance current path, so that all the arcing energy flows into the arc quenching device and ceases to flow into the unintended arcing fault. But by now you're probably asking yourself, how can I be sure that this is always going to be the path of lowest impedance? Because we're actually introducing some impedance by creating a secondary arcing fault. Wouldn't it be possible to introduce too much impedance so the current wouldn't all flow into the arc quenching device and would still feed the unintended arcing fault? Fortunately, the answer is pretty simple. First of all, UL 1558, which is a UL standard for metal enclosed low voltage switchgear, states that the minimum distance between exposed power conductors is 1 inch. So that means inside our switchgear, all of the uninsulated busbar and other power conductors are at least 1 inch apart, and in most cases, far more than 1 inch apart. So by making the contacts inside the arc containment vessels less than 1 inch apart, when we create an arcing fault across them, the laws of physics guarantee that the arcing fault will be lower impedance than any arcing fault that could occur across exposed power conductors inside the switchgear. Second, typical arc faults will eventually self-extinguish. That is, if you ignite an arcing fault inside any piece of equipment and supply it with current and voltage for an unlimited period of time, the arcing fault will self-extinguish. The equipment will first blow up and blow apart, and then the two conductors across which the arc is occurring will melt and vaporize far enough apart so that the arc can no longer span the gap, thus self-extinguishing. So we ensure that the arc will not self-extinguish inside the arc quenching device by using special contact material with an extremely high melting point. Second, we prevent all of that arc energy from escaping into the environment. The arc containment vessels don't vent out any arc gases. They contain all of that energy and therefore ensure that they are the most hospitable locations for the arcing to occur. So all of the arc energy will flow into the arc quenching device. It will instantly extinguish the unintended arcing fault, and the arcing will continue fully contained inside the arc quenching device until the upstream breaker opens up and de-energizes the equipment. And this entire process takes place extremely quickly. It takes about 2 milliseconds for the relay to detect the arcing fault and another 2 milliseconds for the arc quenching device to activate, commutate, and contain all of that arc fault energy. That's a total of 4 milliseconds, and that's the number that you'll use when calculating the incident energy of the switchgear.
John? Hey, it's Eric. We just had a multi-million dollar arc flash event on that old gear, and luckily, no one was hurt, but they very easily could have been. I want to swing by your Power Systems Experience Center to see that arc quenching switchgear. We're going to be ordering our new switchgear immediately, and I need to make sure we include the arc quenching switchgear.
Absolutely. Stop by. I'll be happy to show it to you. I'm really excited about this new option. I think it's exactly what you need.
In your search for arc flash safety solutions, there are many options. But for new switchgear applications, where a catastrophic arc flash event could cause significant losses, downtime, and safety concerns, consider Eaton's arc quenching switchgear. If you want to learn more about arc quenching switchgear, Eaton's innovative approach to arc flash safety, contact us or your local Eaton representative to schedule a visit to the Power Systems Experience Center today.